Let's bow our heads in prayer for all the mothers in the room. And it's such a celebration. So happy Mother's Day to everyone who is blessed with children here. So Lord, we just give you thanks for mothers. Lord, each of us in this room are here because you have given us a mother, so we give thanks for them. Lord, I thank you for just the example that all of the mothers in this room that I know are setting for their children. Just an honor to know them and to do ministry with them, Lord. So I just pray that you would bless them today, and that you would make this day that we set apart each and every year for mothers, one of joy, one of celebration, one of thanksgiving, and we thank you for them. Lord, I also just pray for those who desire to be a mother. Lord, I pray that you would be their comfort today. Pray for those who have lost a mother. Lord, I pray that you would be their comfort today. But Lord, we just want to offer everything up to you and give you thanks for all of the good things that you have blessed us with. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so yes, happy Mother's Day, Cathedral Campus. I'm super excited about today. We were at the end of 1 Corinthians, so they were like, all right, it's Mother's Day, we don't really want to jump into a new series yet, so Luke, you choose whatever you want to do. And that's actually, it might sound easy, but it's actually one of the hardest things to do, especially for me at least, as a preacher, choose one out of the million things that God's Word tells us to do, to preach about today. So I finally landed on something, and so we're going to be opening up to 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18. And one of the rhythms that I've been trying to get into more and more, one of the discipleship rhythms that I've been trying to get into, is scripture memory. So if you are a seasoned memorizer of God's Word, good job. If you've never memorized any of God's scripture today, I'm here to help you. 1 Corinthians 5, you're gonna repeat after me. So verse 16, rejoice always. All right, rejoice always.
Rejoice always.
1 Corinthians 5, verse 16, rejoice always.
Rejoice always.
All right, I usually have to say a name three times to memorize it, but if you have memorized rejoice always, you've memorized your first verse of scripture for those of you who have never done it. Rejoice always, verse 16. Pray without ceasing. All right, repeat after me, pray without ceasing.
Pray without ceasing.
All right, if you memorize those three words, you've memorized your second verse of scripture today. Congratulations, you guys are rolling right now. Verse 18, this one's going to be a little harder. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and give thanks. The title of the sermon is, Let's Be a Church That Always Does These Three Things. So when you jump into a new book of scripture, we're actually jumping into the end of a new book. So 1 Thessalonians, you want to give context. So when you're studying scripture, you want to know who the original author was, who the original audience was. So I'm going to help you out there a little bit. So if you want to turn your Bibles to Acts 17, verses 1 through 9, Paul, this is when Paul is in Thessalonica. This will give us a bit of context. Most scholars believe that this is one of the earliest of Paul's letters, maybe even the first that he wrote. So starting in verse 1 of Acts 17, now when they had passed through Amphipolis, I'm sorry, I'm going to botch these names, and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul went in, as was his custom, and on the third Sabbath day he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving to them it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, and saying, this is Jesus, whom I proclaim to you is the Christ. And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, and did a great many of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women. So it's just a weird way to say a lot of the leading women. Verse 5, But the Jews were jealous, and taking some of the wicked men of the rabble, I love that, the wicked men of the rabble, they formed a mob, set the city in an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out in the crowd. And when they could not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the believers of this before the city authorities and shouting, "These men have turned the world upside down, have come here, these men who have turned the world upside down have come here also, and Jason has received them. And they are all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus." And the people of the cities, their stories and authorities were disturbed when they heard these things. And when they had taken the money as security from Jason and the rest, they let them go. So this is kind of the context. So Paul, he goes to the city, he reasons with them, he wins people to Christ. People are like, "Oh, that makes sense to me. I'm going to follow this Jesus." And then pretty much immediately, there is a persecution of this church, of these new believers. They're immediately given the test, the testing of their faith. Do you actually believe this? And many of them are persecuted. And this persecution, it ranges from taking money for security and letting them go, or beatings, or imprisonments, or even death. So Paul, he knows these people that he's writing this letter to. He has suffered with them. He has been persecuted with them. And then we jump back into what is verse 16, "Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances." Those seem like weird things to say to people that are being persecuted. Those seem like weird things to say that people to people who are being beaten and killed. But Paul reminds us that we should have this eternal mind state. In the first three verses of this, as we continue in our context of the scripture, he celebrates their faithfulness. He celebrates the faithfulness of the church in Thessalonica. And then in chapters 4 and 5, he challenges them to grow. So we're going to jump in to verse 16. "Rejoice always." So rejoice in the good times. Rejoice. We rejoice every time somebody comes up here and proclaims faith in Christ, right? At baptisms, we rejoice in the Lord and his sovereignty and his grace that allows us to understand the coming to know Christ. Steph and I, and when we got married in September 21st, 2019, we had a celebration. We celebrated in front of our family and our friends and before God, a rejoiceful moment of two lives coming together as one. So we celebrate those things. We're rejoicing. We celebrate when sports teams win a championship. My dad's here, and my whole family's are White Sox fans, but I'm a Cubs fan. So in 2016, I rejoiced. And then I've been sad ever since. In Revelation 7, we're going to see this rejoicing at before the throne of God. Starting in verse 9, "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one can number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes and palm branches in their hand, crying out with a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.'" And then verse 12, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." We are going to be rejoicing always. But in this life, and when Paul's writing to the church in Thessalonica, and even in our lives, we're called to even rejoice in our suffering. I don't know what season of life that most of you are in, but I know that at least in some area of our lives, there's suffering. James 1, verses 2 and 3 say, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete." We are a people that on this earth that is imperfect will suffer. And to all of the believers that are in this room, there is a joy that we should have. There is a rejoicing always, even in that suffering when we face it. It's a weird reality of a believer, right? You rejoice. How many of us have been at a funeral, right? And you go to a funeral of a believer and you go to a funeral of a non-believer, and it's a night and day difference. We're not rejoicing in the fact that our loved one is dead, right? But in the one hand, we're rejoicing that they are alive again in Christ. But when you go to a funeral of a non-believer, there's a lot different tone. There's a lot different feeling at those funerals, right? We see in Acts 5, 40 through 42, the apostles get arrested. The Lord opens up the doors and says, okay, go back out into the city in which you were just arrested and continue to proclaim my name. So then the people that arrested them, aren't these the people that we just threw in jail? What are they doing out here? So they get arrested again. And one of the leading Pharisees comes to the people, and this is one of my favorite parts of Scripture because to me, it proves that what we're doing here is not folly. He said, there's a guy, the Thaddeus. He had 400 followers, and after he died, the followers they were strong for a while, and then they faltered. There's Judas, the Galilean, and the same thing happened. He brought some people with him, and people were following him. He died, and then the movement kind of stopped. So same with this Jesus. If this Jesus, he dies, and his followers, they're just going to fade away unless it's of God. So just leave them be. They're not going to continue to be arrested and imprisoned for this guy if he isn't who they say he is. So then in verse 40 of chapter 5 in Acts, they said, and when they called the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching that Christ is Jesus. They were imprisoned, they were beaten, they were instructed never to speak of this again. And what was their heart posture? It was rejoicing. And obviously they continued to preach the gospel because all of us have heard the gospel. The life verse that we have for Judah is 1 Peter 1, 8 and 9. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with a joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. So in suffering, how can we rejoice? How did the apostles rejoice in suffering? It's because if you believe in him and you've experienced God, you rejoice with a joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory. Each and every one of us who have placed their faith in Christ has experienced him, has experienced his goodness, has decided, Jesus, you are worth my life. You are worth giving up even my life for. So we rejoice in our suffering because we have this eternal mindset. There's something that happens within us when the Holy Spirit indwells in us after we place our faith in Christ that gives us this eternal mindset. So we rejoice in our good times, and we rejoice even in our suffering. Verse 17, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. So we want to be a church that is a praying church. Hebrews 5, we're taking this after the one who we lay our life down for. Hebrews 5, 7 through 9 says, in the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to those who obey him. Pray without ceasing. That sounds, first of all, it sounds kind of exhausting, and it sounds unattainable, doesn't it? Why are you guys not praying right now? Pray, right? Pray without ceasing. What does that mean? What is that? It's a heart posture that you are in constant communication with God. Praying without ceasing isn't, okay, for the next 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, I'm going to go in a room and pray. You would die probably very quickly because you don't eat anything. Praying without ceasing isn't just bowing your head and praying. Praying without ceasing is having a constant communication with your Heavenly Father. There's a great, my favorite book that I've ever read is called Let the Nations Be Glad. John Piper wrote it. And if you were ever a professor in one of my classes, you probably got this quote on the paper because I always put it in there. It's my favorite quote. I'm going to paraphrase it. We kind of talk about this battleship mentality and cruise ship mentality. We've been talking about that for a while, that we're all on a battleship. We all have a job to do. We're not on a cruise ship. We're not just eating shrimp and getting the free cocktails all day. We're on this battleship. But John Piper kind of uses the same military language to talk about prayer. He says, when you pray, prayer is not a peacetime megaphone. When we pray, we're not just sitting here with a megaphone. God, I really need this. Are you there? God, can you do this for my family? God, can you do this in my life? God, thank you, but can you? It's not this megaphone that we have. Prayer is a wartime walkie-talkie. If any of you are in the military or have seen any good military movies, there's always a guy with the walkie-talkie, and he's one of the most valuable people in the platoon. Right? He's always in constant communication with the commander or with people. Hey, there's something coming in. You guys got to hide. Or, hey, we need more reinforcements here. And there's someone on the other end that's answering in real time. When we pray, we don't just have a megaphone talking to somebody that's just listening to us. We have a walkie-talkie and a constant communication with the God of the universe that cares about us, that loves us. So let's use praying without ceasing. Let's change our mindset from a megaphone to a walkie-talkie. And John Piper uses this imagery as in the book because he's talking about the spiritual warfare that we go through. Spiritual warfare isn't really a thing that we really preach, like, oh yeah, we're going through the spiritual warfare. It's not as in your face as in other parts of the world. It's not as in your face in our context. But it's going on. It is definitely going on. We are in a war for the souls of people of this city, of this country, of this world, that the enemy is trying to win as well. So we are in a war, and we need to have that walkie-talkie communication with our commander that's telling us to go, that's telling us what to say and who to be. Praying without ceasing, just remember the walkie-talkie. God is listening, but he's also speaking. Steph and I are going to South Korea. We actually leave tomorrow, and I'm very excited. I've never been. We've been trying to go since we got married, but pandemic happened, and then Judah didn't get his passport and then last year. So we get to finally go, and we're leaving tomorrow. And even before I met Stephanie, I read a book on the Pyongyang revival. So Pyongyang is actually the capital of North Korea, modern-day North Korea. But in the early 1900s, 1905 through 1907, Korea was just one country. So the Pyongyang revival happened by a few Christian pastors, which Korea was predominantly Confucius, Buddhist, shamanism, I don't even know what that is, Taoism. So that was like the main religious influences of Korea, of the Korean Peninsula. There's a few missionaries that came, and there began to be small pockets of believers in Korea. And in 1907, a pastor he held this kind of conference. They were hearing about revivals that were happening in Great Britain and all these other places. So they get on, they come together, and they say, we're going to do three things. They began to preach the word. They began all-day prayers. And this really started off the practice of dawn prayer in Korea, which is still church's practice to this day. So they get up at 5 a.m. every morning as a church, and they pray together. That's a great story, right? Good. They're still praying? Great. They went from a country that had maybe 2,000 to 3,000 believers to within the last 5 years, they've sent out the second most missionaries in the world. They're a nation that sends out the second most missionaries in the world, and they're most likely going to surpass the United States very soon.
Amen.
Yeah, amen. And that was a little bit over 100 years ago, to go from a very small group of believers in a room that said, we're going to dedicate our life to praying without ceasing. And what did God do? He blessed them. God blessed their prayer without ceasing. They weren't just sitting in a room saying, God, do this, but I don't want to listen to you. I only have a megaphone. They were in constant communication, hearing and speaking to the one that's able to do all of those things. So I want to encourage us again. Harvest Bible Chapel needs to be a church of prayer. We need to be. If those things that you're suffering with, if those things that you see that are wrong with the world, if those things that you listen to on the news and impact your family and impact your loved ones and impact your coworkers and impact the people around you, and you say, well, there's nothing I can really do. That seems too big for me. That seems even too big for people in this room. You're right, it is. It is too big for us. But it's not too big for our God. It's not too big for the God that's on the other end of that walkie-talkie. That's going to give us the commission. That's going to give us the commands. That's going to give us the way that we should live to then win some. So I want to encourage you this Wednesday. I want to tug on your heartstrings. That was my purpose of that. This Wednesday, we have a prayer meeting right in this room at 7 p.m. We do worship and we do prayer. I would highly encourage you to come to it. Harvest Bible Chapel needs to be a church that prays. We need to. That's it. We need to be a church that prays. And we need to be a church that prays together. I'm going to read a quote. I don't know the source, but Stephanie gave it to me yesterday from where we get all of our great quotes from, Instagram. In the Bible, when Job had everything, he prayed. When he had nothing, he still prayed. Prayer isn't about your circumstance. It's about who God is. God calls us to be a prayerful people. God calls us in this letter to pray without ceasing. So I've given you the analogy of the walkie-talkie, but I really want to hone in on this point. Prayer is something, it's like a muscle you build. It's like going to the gym. You're not going to go to the gym and start deadlifting, I don't know, what's a lot of deadlift? 400 pounds. Obviously, I don't deadlift. You're not going to go on the bench press and you're not going to put on two 45s on each side and a 25 on each side the first time you're in the gym and just start pumping it out. Working out, you have to build strength. Just like in all of these disciplines, in scripture memory, start with small verses, like I've given you. You've memorized two of them. Start with small verses. When you pray, start small. It's okay. God, I need help. The best prayer that you can do if you haven't built a rhythm and built a muscle of praying is, God, I don't know how to pray. Help me. Mothers in the room, when your kid comes to you and like, Mom, I don't know how to open this, or Mom, I don't know how to do this, are you just like, yeah, I'm not going to teach you that. Yeah, figure it out on your own. Obviously not. So how much more will our Heavenly Father, when we go to him and be like, Lord, I don't know how to pray. Luke told me to pray, and this is a walkie-talkie, but I feel like I'm alone here. I feel like I have a megaphone. Lord, I don't know. Like, do that. That's a great starting place, because God is faithful to answer. He is hearing all of that. He is faithful to answer that. We have to be a praying people. We have to. We have to. There's too much going on in this world. There's too much warfare, spiritual, physical, to not be a people that pray. We have to. Verse 18, thanking. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. I really enjoyed the process of this verse, because like those types of things, like praying without ceasing, that seems insurmountable. Give thanks in all circumstances. Like, God, my circumstances are really, really hard right now. How do I give thanks? How do I give thanks in that? God, how do I give thanks when my family member is sick? God, how do I give thanks when I'm sick? God, how do I give thanks when I don't know where my next check is coming from? God, how do I give thanks when I don't know what is happening in my life? Lord, how do I give thanks when I'm too depressed to get out of bed in the morning? Lord, how do I give thanks when this anxiety feels like there's an elephant on my chest? Lord, how do I give thanks when, Lord, how do I give thanks when, Lord, how do I give thanks when? And studying this passage, it was really helpful to me. The passage says, give thanks in all circumstances. It does not say give thanks for all circumstances. So how do we give thanks in all circumstances? Number one, because God is so good. Even in the midst of all of those examples that I laid out, God is so good. For Christians, we are thankful because of our eternal mindset. This goes back to that first point. How do we rejoice in our suffering? How do we be thankful in all circumstances? Because there is a promise of Scripture that I believe that this word is infallible, that there will be a day with no more tears. There will be a day with no more pain. There will be a day where we're communing with our Heavenly Father. And if you are a Christian in this place, you have to believe that, and you have to continue to tell yourself that. God has made us and wired us in this really funny way that if we're not reminded every Sunday about God's goodness and we sing to him, we tend to falter. God has made us and wired us. If we don't have communication with our loved ones for an extended period of time, that relationship begins to sever. In the same way that God has wired us in those ways, God has wired us that we have to be reminded of an eternal perspective. A lot of us are scared of the book of Revelation. It's one of my favorite books, because at the end, we win. Like, we win. How great of a story is it that if you knew the final days of your life, if you knew the final outcome of a season of sports, if you knew what you were going to be in 20 years and it was victory, how much more would you have a pep in your step? How much more would you be, God, I'm so thankful. We know it. Read the end of Revelation. We win. So let's have an eternal mindset. And I want to remind you that we need an eternal mindset because the things of this world are not very, they don't remind us of eternity. There is such a lack of sanctity of life in this city that it sickens me. There's such a lack of love and care for others that it pains me to see. And if I'm not reminded of God's goodness, and if I'm not reminded that we win, man, it feels like we lose a whole lot. If I'm not reminded that one day I'm going to be in the throne room with a multitude of my closest friends singing to a God that's worthy of it all, man, that's a hard place to be. If I'm not reminded that my suffering produces endurance, which produces character, which produces hope, and if I just stay in that suffering, man, that's a hard place to be. So we give thanks in all circumstances because we know the outcome. We know the outcome. Paul was giving thanks. This was one of his earliest letters. So in 2 Corinthians, he goes through this long list, and he probably didn't experience all of these things yet, but he goes through this super long list of things that I was shipwrecked, I've been lashed 40 times minus one, so that's actually such an interesting thing. Like 40 lashes was, if you don't die, then you're off of your penalty. So if the person wasn't almost dead, they just do 39 lashes and then stop so that he wouldn't be found not guilty or whatever the case may be. So he was lashed 40 times minus one multiple times. He was stoned where they thought he was dead, so they dragged him out of the city. They're like, we don't have to worry about him anymore. He lost friends. He lost family. He lost so many things, not only to them not wanting to be around him because he was a Christian now, but he lost dear brothers and sisters in the faith because they had the endurance and they had the eternal mindset to say, I'm willing to die for this. And that's suffering. Those losses are hard. But that's the same guy that's saying, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. If you've never placed your faith in Christ, I want to explain what a Christian's worldview and eternal mindset looks like. It looks like myself and every single person in this room, whether they've placed their faith in Christ or not, they've separated themselves from Christ because of their sin, because of life choices and things that you've done. God is a completely holy God who is unchanging and has never failed. And every single person in this room, myself probably the most, has. So there's a separation between an eternal God, a holy God, and a human. And if we wanted to, we couldn't make our way right, because once that separation happens, there's a great chasm. There's a great divide that you can't cross. So God sees this, and he gives the law, and he gives ways to sacrifice to make yourself right with God in holiness and righteousness. But humans continue to fail. And we can't just keep killing animals forever. So what God did is he sent his only son. And he said the only way that we can make this right is if he goes and lives a perfect life and dies in the place of every single person in this room, myself included. So Jesus comes and he fulfills prophecies of the Old Testament. He lives a life that's perfect. And he gets charged with a crime that he did not commit. And he gets put on a cross and suffers a death that he did not deserve for you and for me. And he says, if you want to have this eternal mindset, if you want to win, you have to do one thing. And that's believe those words. Believe the words of Jesus and do them. And when you make that decision, you get to be a part of the team. And it's not this, okay, you're a part of the team, go sit on the bench. You're put in as a starter right away. Go and make disciples. Teach them everything that I have said and tell them to obey it. You go from the opposite, you go from the enemy, you go from the other team, the opposing team, to a starter with a great mission. Go and make disciples. So if you've never placed your faith in Christ, do it. I beg you. Do it. Please. Because we win. And that pain and that suffering, we might look crazy, but we're rejoicing in it. Because we know the outcome. I'm going to read one story. And then I'll get off the stage. So Martin Burnham, June 7th, 2002. This is from a book that I recently got to continually remind me of the eternal perspective, of the eternal mindset. It says, if I have to go, I want to go out strong for the Lord. Those were some of 42-year-old Martin Burnham's last words before he was killed. It was supposed to be a relaxing and romantic time, celebrating their 18th wedding anniversary at a beach resort in the western Philippines. But it soon turned into a nightmare. Abu Saif, a Muslim extremist group, ransacked the resort and kidnapped the guests, including New Tribes missionaries Martin and Gracia Burnham. The hostages were threatened and forced to march with their captors through the streaming jungles, trying to avoid the Philippine army that was tracking them. Burnham was forced to carry bags of rice through the rain. The months of being in captivity and trudging through the jungles had worn down his boots, and he slipped often. Burnham never complained. He picked himself up and kept walking, even offering to help others along the way. He and Gracia refused to give in to this fear. They spent their time in prayer, thanking the Lord for this opportunity to minister to other hostages and to suffer for his sake. They led the group in singing inspirational songs, and Burnham even tried to share the gospel with the guerrillas who captured him. Burnham risked his life for Christ and his mission to help others. After hearing of the capture, the Philippine army increased its search for the guerrillas. As they got closer, Abu Shabaid, the leader of Abu Saif, ordered his subordinates, if the Philippine soldiers come any closer, I want you to kill the American missionaries. Bullets flew through the air between the guerrillas and the soldiers. When the smoke cleared, Burnham and a Filipino nurse, Eddie Bora, were dead. Gracia had a bullet in her thigh. Burnham wasn't afraid to die. During his time in captivity, he encouraged and strengthened the hostage, praying with them and for them. He was thankful in all circumstances. While all the hostages prayed for release, Burnham was sending up prayers of thanksgiving. Both he and Gracia were steadfast in their faith despite all the tremendous difficulties that they had kept in Christ. Martin Burnham was an example of generosity, love, and faith. He generously lived his life to share the gospel at all costs. This guy was faced with it. He was faced with it, and It was just so crazy reading this as I was preparing. What were the words that kept coming? Thankfulness. He was thankful. He was joyful. When life throws these situations at us, we're going to look crazy. If you're on this team, you're not going to look like the rest of the world. You're going to look crazy. Because in our suffering and in our rejoicing, we're going to look different in our suffering. Because we're going to pray through it, we're going to be thankful, and we're going to rejoice. Let me pray for us. Lord, we give you praise, we give you thanks. On this day that we get to celebrate mothers and motherhood, we ultimately are celebrating you for all things, in all circumstances. Lord, I pray, Lord, I pray that we'd be a church of prayer. I beg of you to stir inside the hearts and the minds of people in this room, that we would be a church of prayer. Lord, I pray that we would be a church that rejoices in all things, even in the suffering, and that we give thanks to you who are worthy of it all. In Jesus' name.